Over the last week, we've chatted with three party leaders hoping to gain power in Thursday's general election.
And with just 2 days to go until the country heads to the polls this morning, it's the turn of Liberal Democrat leader Jo Swinson in the last of our exclusive interviews. So good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Busy time, especially for a mum.
Absolutely, yeah. It's run up to Christmas. Normally there's enough going on and just, you know, throw a general election into the mix. So yeah, quite a long to-do list.
You are covering the miles. Is it going to be worth it? Can you win?
Look, I think we can win lots more Liberal Democrat MPs, and you know what we're setting out to do in this election. We want to remain in the European Union so that the future for our country will be better, and I believe that is absolutely still possible.
Sure. Do you think you can be Prime Minister?
Well, I'd love that job, but looking where the polls are at now, I think that's clearly looking pretty unlikely. But I absolutely think we can still achieve our overarching goal, which is, can we stop Brexit? Can we get a final say referendum to put the specific Brexit deal to the public?
Well,
I believe that's still doable.
On the subject of Brexit, you pledged to cancel Brexit if you won power at the general election. Stop Brexit appear in large capital letters on the front of the Lib Dems manifesto, revoking Article 50 immediately. You've U-turned on that.
No, we still want to stop Brexit, and we want to stop Brexit in any way possible. Well, to be fair, we have campaigned for a referendum for 3.5 years. We've led that campaign. We've tabled amendments in Parliament, you know, 17 times to try to get that people's vote on a specific Brexit deal. Because, you know, there's a lot more information available now about what Brexit looks like, and even the Brexiteers can't agree on what it should be. You know, some people think Theresa May's deal was Brexit, some people think that wasn't Brexity enough. I think that, you know, it's such a mess. It really should go back to the public.
I think the problem is that people find it hard to trust your party because you've made a U-turn on that. You know, the U-turn on tuition fees was a huge one. The Labour Party have accused you of betraying young people. How can people trust in your party that you're going to do all these things that you say?
Well, I mean, I think on the issue of remaining in the EU, we have been absolutely consistent. We have been the most pro-European party, you know, since our inception more than 30 years ago. I totally accept the issue of tuition fees as an issue of trust. It's something that we got wrong, and I am sorry about that. We did get it wrong. And I suppose what I would say to people is I've learned from that, because I remember how I felt in those meetings when it was being discussed, and I should have trusted my instincts more. And, you know, we, as I say, we've learned the lessons from that. And if you look at what we set out in our plan for the future, this time round, it's a plan that is deliverable.
But also with when you were in coalition, you voted 9 times for the bedroom tax. You also voted for private tendering of the NHS.
And I have said, again, I'm sorry that I voted for the bedroom tax, because I don't think that's something that we should have let through.
So did you change your mind?
No. I mean, what we were doing in that circumstance, we were in a coalition government where the Liberal Democrats did not get to have our own way all of the time. And there's clearly lots of fights that we had with the Conservatives, lots of fights that we won. You know, they wanted to cut another £12 billion out of welfare. They wanted to introduce a 2-child cap on benefits, which we stopped them doing. They obviously introduced it once they won a majority in 2015. So we won a lot of those battles, but we lost some too.
Do you agree on private tendering for the NHS?
Look, I think our NHS should always be free to people who use it. Obviously, sometimes private providers provide, you know, operations. If that's a way to cut a waiting list, then, you know, I think what's important is that people are getting the care that they need and that they're not having to pay for it.
So essentially, selling off part of the
NHS? No, not at all. It's the NHS sometimes using a private contractor, whether that's, you know, they're buying in IT from a private contractor, or sometimes, I've seen this in my own area, sometimes there's a private hospital which is used to help to clear a waiting list on a certain number of operations. If that means people get treated more quickly, I don't think we should let ideology get in the way of making sure that people can have the operations that they need.
After the previous coalition, some say unsuccessful coalition, what would the other parties, Labour or the Conservatives, need to offer you in order to entice you into a coalition again?
Well, at the moment, both Labour and the Conservatives have gone off to the far left and the far right. They're in a very, very extreme positions. So coalition is not on the cards with those parties as they currently are.
And so what would they have to do then?
Well, I mean, you know, I will always work with people who I share values with and where we want to achieve something that is the same. And, you know, we've done that in the last 2 years, trying to campaign for a people's vote. I've worked with people from the Labour Party, from the Conservative Party, from the Green Party, from the Nationalist parties. And, you know, we've successfully stopped Brexit twice this year. So I think working with others, it can be very effective, but that's different to a formal coalition.
So what are the terms? What are the terms
I'm not, as a Liberal Democrat, I'm not going to use the votes of Liberal Democrat MPs to put either Boris Johnson or Jeremy Corbyn into number 10. Bluntly, I just don't think either of them are up to the job. I think both will be hugely damaging for our country in different ways. I don't think Boris Johnson cares about anyone but himself. I think we've seen that in his reaction to the events of the last day or two. And I'm deeply worried. And I mean, you asked when he was here on your sofa, Jeremy Corbyn, about his record on tackling anti-Semitism. You know,
well, to be fair, we also asked the Prime Minister on Islamophobia.
Exactly. And on both of those issues, you know, these are people who are not showing that they're prepared to stand up for the rights of individuals. And I think that does disqualify them from being fit to be Prime Minister, and that's why I won't vote for them to do so.
But having said that, standing up for the rights of individuals with those taxes and that coalition government, you were part of making life harder for a lot of people. So you don't stand up for the individuals.
So we didn't get everything right. And also, it was not possible for there not to be any cuts after 2010. We had had a huge financial crash. The Labour Party went into that election saying that there was going to need to be cuts to balance the books. And actually, if you look at what we delivered, the scale of the cuts was roughly along the lines of what Labour had set out. And of course, that was painful. I mean, I didn't go into politics to make cuts. You know, dealing with the aftermath of the financial crash was genuinely very difficult. And I'm not going to say we got everything of that right. I would have preferred we saw more tax rises and less spending cuts. But we were trying to genuinely do the best we could. And we got huge amounts of our own Lib Dem policies through, more money for the poorest pupils in schools, cutting taxes for people on low pay, introducing same-sex marriage. Those things have made life better for people right across the country.
You also want to change the law to automatically recognise non-binary gender identities and now allow people to self-identify without medical evidence. There has been concern that how would you propose to protect women in women-only spaces from people possibly acting in a predatory way? I mean, some people have sort of said this is anti-feminist, actually. Well,
it's not.
I mean, throwing women under the bus to get your own votes through.
No, I mean, I'm a feminist. Let's be clear of the problem that we're trying to solve here. You know, there's thousands of people in our country who don't identify as male or female, who are transgendered or non-binary. One in four of those young trans people have attempted suicide.
Yeah.
Right? And this is a
cross for many people.
Exactly. So there is a very vulnerable group in society here who face a huge amount of discrimination. Mm-hmm. Now, self-identification is already the law for most things. I mean, if you're accessing services, you know, you don't show a birth certificate
when you go along to a refuge. I agree.
This is just about a change to birth certificates.
What happens if you're in, you know, a female toilet? And unfortunately, the world is the world as it is, and there will be people out there who will use those laws in a way that is not good.
I have to say, I think there's quite a lot of scaremongering about this, because what we're proposing is just a change in the way in which people can apply to change the birth certificate. At the moment, it's a very bureaucratic process.
You say the scaremongering, but isn't that because wouldn't it be right to say that some women actually would genuinely be scared?
So I get that there is genuine concern, but there's also a lot of sensationalism around it. Because if we take the toilet example, right? What is being proposed about making it a smoother process for people to change the birth certificate has no bearing whatsoever. I mean, when was the last time you were asked for your birth certificate when you went into a lady's loo? It just doesn't happen, right? Mm. You know, if somebody really wants to be predatory, a man wants to be predatory in a lady's loo, all he needs to do is go in there with a mop and cleaning bucket, because you always get those signs saying male operatives on duty. Mm-hmm. What we've had since this debate happens is actually you get lots of women who aren't conforming to the kind of feminine stereotype. They might have very short hair, they might dress in a more masculine way. They're now being challenged for using the ladies' loo, and they're being made to feel unwelcome in that space. So actually, the sensationalist media debate about this is having, yes, a negative impact on trans people, and it's also having a negative impact on women as well. So I just think we need to sort of calm down the way in which this is talked about, work out how we solve genuine issues, and where there are issues of safety, it is about individual risk assessments and dealing with the specific case.
Yes, just talk a little bit about money. Because you've pledged that all children aged 2 to 4 qualify for 35 hours a week of childcare, £13 billion a year. With the NHS, you've pledged to raise £7 billion a year over 5 years. That's £35 billion. Where's the money coming from?
Well, I mean, the biggest spending commitment there, as you say, free childcare. Also extending it actually to parents who are going back to work from 9 months, which is closing a really important gap because we all know somebody who has not been able to go back to work because of the cost of childcare. Yeah. That policy is paid for. £10 billion of that comes from the rise in corporation tax that we've set out, which would still be a competitive low rate, but it would help free up that money for that free childcare. And also the rest of that money comes from changes to capital gains tax. On the case of the NHS, we've said, very honestly, straightforwardly, we would put up income tax by a penny in the pound, and that would raise that money, that £7 billion a year for the NHS. And I just think people should be honest about where they're going to fund their promises from. And, you know, we're doing that. The independent think tank that kind of marks the politicians' homework on this, the IFS, they've said that our plans add up. And that isn't what people are getting from the other parties.
And just before we go, yesterday you were talking about the fact that you'd been advised to wear a lower cut top to boost your party's election chances. Why do you think it is that women, I mean, not just in what you do, but everywhere, are judged by right. what they wear?
Yeah, I mean, Holly, you'll have experienced this, you know, and there'll be lots of women watching this who have had all sorts of unsolicited advice, some of it very well-meaning, but, you know, yes.
Was it from someone in your party that said it?
Actually, in that particular case, it was, but I get Facebook messages all the time, you know, speak differently.
Does that not worry you?
Someone in your party said, wear a lower-cut dress.
Yeah, I mean, a party member sent a message, so not somebody within the kind of the team. But, I mean, look, I mean, and I get this, some of the stuff I get from people in other parties is perhaps less able to be said on, you know, on air in the morning. You know, there's a lot of, you know, abuse and focus on women in public life. And I want to change that. And one of the ways in which we change that is actually by getting more women into leadership positions. And if I can, by being leader of the Liberal Democrats, by going out there and fighting a general election for what I believe in, if I can in some way, you know, inspire other young women into politics and show them that it can be done and take some of the brickbats and just go, do you know what? You know, we're gonna change this over time. And the way to do it is by stepping up to be a leader.
Have you got your Christmas tree up yet?
No. It's a bit of a sore point in our house. My five-year-old really wants it up, but I've promised him we're going to do it on Saturday.
This weekend. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.